A Waif on the Plains. By Bret Harte. Podcast 2 of 5. Chapter 4. The dash forward to the train, securely held in the saddle by the arms of their deliverers, was a secret joy to the children that seemed only too quickly over. The resistless gallop of the fiery mustangs, the rush of the night wind, the gathering darkness in which the distant wagons, now halted and facing them, looked like domed huts in the horizon, all these seemed but a delightful and fitting climax to the events of the day. In the sublime forgetfulness of youth, all they had gone through had left no embarrassing record behind it, they were willing to repeat their experiences on the morrow, confident of some equally happy end. And when Clarence, timidly reaching his hand towards the horsehair reins lightly held by his companion, had them playfully yielded up to him by that bold and confident rider, the boy felt himself indeed a man. But a greater surprise was in store for them. As they neared the wagons, now formed into a circle with a certain degree of military formality, they could see that the appointments of the strange party were larger and more liberal than their own, or indeed anything they had ever known of the kind. 40 or 50 horses were tethered within the circle, and the campfires were already blazing. Before one of them a large tent was erected, and through the parted flaps could be seen a table actually spread with a white cloth. Was it a school feast, or was this their ordinary household arrangement? Clarence and Susie thought of their own dinners, usually laid on bare boards beneath the sky, or under the low hood of the wagon in rainy weather, and marveled. And when they finally halted, and were lifted from their horses, and passed one wagon fitted up as a bedroom and another as a kitchen, they could only nudge each other with silent appreciation. But here again the difference already noted in the quality of the sensations of the two children was observable. Both were equally and agreeably surprised. But Susie's wonder was merely the sense of novelty and inexperience, and a slight disbelief in the actual necessity of what she saw, while Clarence, whether from some previous general experience or peculiar temperament, had the conviction that what he saw here was the usual custom, and what he had known with the Silsbees was the novelty. The feeling was attended with a slight sense of wounded pride for Susie, as if her enthusiasm had exposed her to ridicule. The man who had carried him, and seemed to be the head of the party, had already preceded them to the tent, and presently reappeared with a lady with whom he had exchanged a dozen hurried words. They seemed to refer to him and Susie, but Clarence was too much preoccupied with the fact that the lady was pretty, that her clothes were neat and thoroughly clean, that her hair was tidy and not rumpled, and that, although she wore an apron, it was as clean as her gown, and even had ribbons on it, to listen to what was said. And when she ran eagerly forward, and with a fascinating smile lifted the astonished Susie in her arms, Clarence, in his delight for his young charge, quite forgot that she had not noticed him. The bearded man, who seemed to be the lady's husband, evidently pointed out the omission, with some additions that Clarence could not catch, for after saying, with a pretty pout, "Well, why shouldn't he?" she came forward with the same dazzling smile, and laid her small and clean white hand upon his shoulder. "And so you took good care of the dear little thing? She's such an angel, isn't she? And you must love her very much." Clarence colored with delight. It was true it had never occurred to him to look at Susie in the light of a celestial visitant, and I fear he was just then more struck with the fair complimenter than the compliment to his companion, but he was pleased for her sake. He was not yet old enough to be conscious of the sex's belief in its irresistible domination over mankind at all ages, and that Johnny in his check apron would be always a hopeless conquest of Jeanette in her pinafore, and that he ought to have been in love with Susie. Howbeit, the lady suddenly whisked her away to the recesses of her own wagon, to reappear later, washed, curled, and beribboned like a new doll, and Clarence was left alone with the husband and another of the party. "Well, my boy, you haven't told me your name yet."
"Clarence, sir."
"So Susie calls you, but what else?"
"Clarence Brandt."
"Any relation to Colonel Brandt?" asked the second man carelessly. "He was my father," said the boy, brightening under this faint prospect of recognition in his loneliness. The two men glanced at each other.
The leader looked at the boy curiously, and said, "Are you the son of Colonel Brandt, of Louisville?"
"Yes, sir," said the boy, with a dim stirring of uneasiness in his heart.
"But he's dead now," he added finally.
"Ah, when did he die?" said the man quickly.
"Oh, a long time ago. I don't remember him much. I was very little," said the boy, half apologetically.
"Ah, you don't remember him?"
"No," said Clarence shortly. He was beginning to fall back upon that certain dogged repetition which in sensitive children arises from their hopeless inability to express their deeper feelings. He also had an instinctive consciousness that this want of a knowledge of his father was part of that vague wrong that had been done him. It did not help his uneasiness that he could see that one of the two men, who turned away with a half-laugh, misunderstood or did not believe him.
"How did you come with the Silsbees?" asked the first man.
Clarence repeated mechanically, with a child's distaste of practical details, how he had lived with an aunt at St. Joe, and how his stepmother had procured his passage with the Silsbees to California, where he was to meet his cousin. All this with a lack of interest and abstraction that he was miserably conscious told against him, but he was yet helpless to resist. The first man remained thoughtful, and then glanced at Clarence's sunburnt hands. Presently his large, good-humored smile returned.
"Well, I suppose you are hungry."
"Yes," said Clarence shyly.
But
what?
"I should like to wash myself a little," he returned hesitatingly, thinking of the clean tent, the clean lady, and Susie's ribbons.
"Certainly," said his friend, with a pleased look.
"Come with me."
Instead of leading Clarence to the battered tin basin and bar of yellow soap which had formed the toilet service of the Silsby party, he brought the boy into one of the wagons, where there was a washstand, a china basin, and a cake of scented soap. Standing beside Clarence, he watched him perform his ablutions with an approving air which rather embarrassed his protege. Presently he said, almost abruptly, "Do you remember your father's house at Louisville?"
"Yes, sir, but it was a long time ago."
Clarence remembered it as being very different from his home at St. Joseph's, but from some innate feeling of diffidence he would have shrunk from describing it in that way. He, however, said he thought it was a large house. Yet the modest answer only made his new friend look at him the more keenly.
"Your father was Colonel Hamilton Brandt, of Louisville, wasn't he?" he said, half confidentially.
"Yes," said Clarence hopelessly.
"Well," said his friend cheerfully, as if dismissing an abstruse problem from his mind, "let's go to supper."
When they reached the tent again, Clarence noticed that the supper was laid only for his host and wife and the second man who was familiarly called Harry, but who spoke of the former always as Mr. and Mrs. Peyton, while the remainder of the party, a dozen men, were at a second campfire, and evidently enjoying themselves in a picturesque fashion. Had the boy been allowed to choose, he would have joined them, partly because it seemed more manly, and partly that he dreaded a renewal of the questioning. But here, Susie, sitting bolt upright on an extemporized high stool, happily diverted his attention by pointing to the empty chair beside her.
"Clarence," she said suddenly, with her usual clear and appalling frankness, "they is chickens and ham and eggs and hot biscuits and lasses, and Mr. Peyton says I can have em all."
Clarence, who had begun suddenly to feel that he was responsible for Susie's deportment and was balefully conscious that she was holding her plated fork in her chubby fist by its middle, and, from his previous knowledge of her, was likely at any moment to plunge it into the dish before her, said softly,
"Hush."
"Yes, you shall, dear," said Mrs. Peyton, with tenderly beaming assurance to Susie and a half-reproachful glance at the boy.
"Eat what you like, darling."
"It's a fork," whispered the still uneasy Clarence, as Susie now seemed inclined to stir her bowl of milk with it.
"Tain't tea, now, Clarence, it's only a split spoon," said Susie.
But Mrs. Peyton, in her rapt admiration, took small note of these irregularities, plying the child with food, forgetting her own meal,
and only stopping at times to lift back the forward straying curls on Susie's shoulders. Mr. Peyton looked on gravely and contentedly. Suddenly the eyes of husband and wife met. "She'd have been nearly as old as this, John," said Mrs. Peyton, in a faint voice. John Peyton nodded without speaking, and turned his eyes away into the gathering darkness. The man Harry also looked abstractedly at his plate, as if he was saying grace. Clarence wondered who she was, and why two little tears dropped from Mrs. Peyton's lashes into Susie's milk, and whether Susie might not violently object to it. He did not know until later that the Peytons had lost their only child, and Susie comfortably drained this mingled cup of a mother's grief and tenderness without suspicion. "I suppose we'll come up with their train early tomorrow, if some of them don't find us tonight," said Mrs. Peyton, with a long sigh and a regretful glance at Susie. "Perhaps we might travel together for a little while," she added timidly. Harry laughed, and Mr. Peyton replied gravely, "I am afraid we wouldn't travel with them, even for company's sake, and," he added, in a lower and graver voice, "it's rather odd the search party hasn't come upon us yet, though I'm keeping Pete and Hank patrolling the trail to meet them." "It's heartless, so it is," said Mrs. Peyton, with sudden indignation. "It would be all very well if it was only this boy, who can take care of himself, but to be so careless of a mere baby like this, it's shameful." For the first time Clarence tasted the cruelty of discrimination. All the more keenly that he was beginning to worship, after his boyish fashion, this sweet-faced, clean, and tender-hearted woman. Perhaps Mr. Peyton noticed it, for he came quietly to his aid. "Maybe they knew better than we in what careful hands they had left her," he said, with a cheerful nod towards Clarence. "And, again, they may have been fooled as we were by engine signs and left the straight road." This suggestion instantly recalled to Clarence his vision in the mesquite. Should he dare tell them? Would they believe him, or would they laugh at him before her? He hesitated, and at last resolved to tell it privately to the husband. When the meal was ended, and he was made happy by Mrs. Peyton's laughing acceptance of his offer to help her clear the table and wash the dishes, they all gathered comfortably in front of the tent before the large campfire. At the other fire the rest of the party were playing cards and laughing, but Clarence no longer cared to join them. He was quite tranquil in the maternal propinquity of his hostess, albeit a little uneasy as to his reticence about the Indian. "Clauns," said Susie, relieving a momentary pause, in her highest voice, "knows how to speak. Speak, Clauns." It appearing from Clarence's blushing explanation that this gift was not the ordinary faculty of speech, but a capacity to recite verse, he was politely pressed by the company for a performance. "Speak, M. Clauns, the boy what stood unto the burnin' deck, and said, the boy, oh, where was he?" said Susie, comfortably lying down on Mrs. Peyton's lap, and contemplating her bare knees in the air. "It's about a boy," she added confidentially to Mrs. Peyton, "whose father wouldn't never stay with him on a burnin' ship, though he said, stay, father, stay, ever so much." With this clear, lucid, and perfectly satisfactory explanation of Mrs. Hammond's Casabianca, Clarence began. Unfortunately, his actual rendering of this popular school performance was more an effort of memory than anything else, and was illustrated by those wooden gestures which a Western schoolmaster had taught him. He described the flames that roared around him, by indicating with his hand a perfect circle, of which he was the axis. He adjured his father, the late Admiral Casabianca, by clasping his hands before his chin, as if wanting to be manacled in an attitude which he was miserably conscious was unlike anything he himself had ever felt or seen before. He described that father faint in death below, and the flag on high, with one single motion. Yet something that the verses had kindled in his active imagination, perhaps, rather than an illustration of the verses themselves, at times brightened his gray eyes, became tremulous in his youthful voice, and I fear occasionally incoherent on his lips. At times, when not conscious of his affected art, the plain and all upon it seemed to him to slip away into the night, the blazing campfire at his feet to wrap him in a fateful glory, and a vague devotion to something he knew not what so possessed him that he communicated it, and probably some of his own youthful delight in extravagant voice, to his hearers, until, when he ceased with a glowing face, he was surprised to find that the card players had deserted their campfires and gathered round the tent. Chapter 5. You didn't say stay, father, stay, enough, clowns, said Susie critically. Then suddenly starting upright in Mrs. Peyton's lap, she continued rapidly, I can dance and sing. I can dance high jamboree. What's high jamboree, dear? Asked Mrs. Peyton. You'll see. Lemme down. And Susie slipped to the ground. The dance of high jamboree, evidently of remote mystical African origin, appeared to consist of three small skips to the right and then to the left, accompanied by the holding up of very short skirts, incessant teetering on the toes of small feet, the exhibition of much bare knee and stocking, and a gurgling accompaniment of childish laughter. Vehemently applauded, it left the little performer breathless, but invincible and ready for fresh conquest. I can sing, too, she gasped hurriedly, as if unwilling that the applause should lapse. I can sing. Oh, dear. Clowns, Pi Tusley, what is it I sing? Ben Bolt, suggested Clarence. Oh, yes. Oh, don't you remember Sweet Ailer's Ben Bolt, began Susie, in the same breath and the wrong key. Sweet Ailer's, with hair so brown, who wept with delight when you gived her a smile, and with knitted brows and appealing recitative, what's er rest of it, clowns? Who trembled with fear at your frown, prompted Clarence. Who trembled with fear at my frown, shrilled Susie. I forget er rest. Wait. I can sing. Praise God, suggested Clarence. Yes. Here Susie, a regular attendant in camp and prayer meetings, was on firmer ground. Promptly lifting her high treble, yet with a certain acquired deliberation, she began, Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. At the end of the second line the whispering and laughing ceased. A deep voice to the right, that of the champion poker player, suddenly rose on the swell of the third line. He was instantly followed by a dozen ringing voices, and by the time the last line was reached it was given with a full chorus, in which the dull chant of teamsters and drivers mingled with the soprano of Mrs. Peyton and Susie's childish treble. Again and again it was repeated, with forgetful eyes and abstracted faces, rising and falling with the night wind and the leap and gleam of the campfires, and fading again like them in the immeasurable mystery of the darkened plain. In the deep and embarrassing silence that followed, at last the party hesitatingly broke up, Mrs. Peyton retiring with Susie after offering the child to Clarence for a perfunctory good-night kiss, an unusual proceeding, which somewhat astonished them both, and Clarence found himself near Mr. Peyton. I think, said Clarence timidly, I saw an engine today. Mr. Peyton bent down towards him. An engine where? He asked quickly, with the same look of doubting interrogatory with which he had received Clarence's name and parentage. The boy for a moment regretted having spoken. But with his old doggedness he particularized his statement. Fortunately, being gifted with a keen perception, he was able to describe the stranger accurately, and to impart with his description that contempt for its subject which he had felt, and which to his frontier auditor established its truthfulness. Peyton turned abruptly away, but presently returned with Harry and another man. You are sure of this, said Peyton, half encouragingly. Yes, sir. As sure as you are that your father is Colonel Brandt and is dead, said Harry, with a light laugh. Tears sprang into the boy's lowering eyes. I don't lie, he said doggedly. I believe you, Clarence, said Peyton quietly. But why didn't you say it before? I didn't like to say it before Susie and her, stammered the boy. Her. Yes, Sir Mrs. Peyton, said Clarence blushingly. Oh, said Harry sarcastically, how blessed polite we are. That'll do. Let up on him,
will you?" said Peyton, roughly, to his subordinate. "The boy knows what he's about. But," he continued, addressing Clarence, "how was it the engine didn't see you?"
"I was very still on account of not waking Susie," said Clarence, and he hesitated.
"And what?" "He seemed more keen watching what you were doing," said the boy boldly.
"That's so," broke in the second man, who happened to be experienced, and as he was to windward o' the boy he was off his scent and bearings. "He was one of their rear scouts, the rest o' them's ahead crossing our track to cut us off.
Ye didn't see anything else?"
"I saw a coyote first," said Clarence, greatly encouraged.
"Hold on," said the expert, as Harry turned away with a sneer.
"That's a sign, too. Wolf don't go where wolf he's been, and coyote don't follow engines there's no pickings.
How long afore did you see the coyote?"
"Just after we left the wagon," said Clarence.
"That's it," said the man, thoughtfully. "He was driven on ahead, or hanging on their flanks.
These engines are betwixt us and that AR train, or following it."
Peyton made a hurried gesture of warning, as if reminding the speaker of Clarence's presence, a gesture which the boy noticed and wondered at. Then the conversation of the three men took a lower tone, although Clarence distinctly heard the concluding opinion of the expert.
"It ain't no good now, Mr. Peyton, and you'd be only exposing yourself on their ground by breaking camp agin tonight. And you don't know that it ain't us they're watchin'. You see, if we hadn't turned off the straight road when we got that first scare from these yer lost children, we might have gone on and walked plump into some cursed trap of those devils. To my mind, we're just in racial expletive luck, and with a good watch and my patrol we're all right to be fixed where we be till daylight."
Mr. Peyton presently turned away, taking Clarence with him.
"As we'll be up early and on the track of your train tomorrow, my boy, you had better turn in now. I put you up in my wagon, and as I expect to be in the saddle most of the night, I reckon I won't trouble you much."
He led the way to a second wagon drawn up beside the one where Susie and Mrs. Peyton had retired, which Clarence was surprised to find fitted with a writing table and desk, a chair, and even a bookshelf containing some volumes. A long locker, fitted like a lounge, had been made up as a couch for him, with the unwonted luxury of clean white sheets and pillowcases. A soft matting covered the floor of the heavy wagon bed, which, Mr. Peyton explained, was hung on center springs to prevent jarring. The sides and roof of the vehicle were of lightly paneled wood, instead of the usual hooked canvas frame of the ordinary emigrant wagon, and fitted with a glazed door and movable window for light and air. Clarence wondered why the big, powerful man, who seemed at home on horseback, should ever care to sit in this office like a merchant or a lawyer, and if this train sold things to the other trains, or took goods, like the peddlers, to towns on the route, but there seemed to be nothing to sell, and the other wagons were filled with only the goods required by the party. He would have liked to ask Mr. Peyton who he was, and have questioned him as freely as he himself had been questioned. But as the average adult man never takes into consideration the injustice of denying to the natural and even necessary curiosity of childhood that questioning which he himself is so apt to assume without right, and almost always without delicacy, Clarence had no recourse. Yet the boy, like all children, was conscious that if he had been afterwards questioned about this inexplicable experience, he would have been blamed for his ignorance concerning it. Left to himself presently, and ensconced between the sheets, he lay for some moments staring about him. The unwonted comfort of his couch, so different from the stuffy blanket in the hard wagon bed which he had shared with one of the teamsters, and the novelty, order, and cleanliness of his surroundings, while they were grateful to his instincts, began in some vague way to depress him. To his loyal nature it seemed a tacit infidelity to his former rough companions to be lying here. He had a dim idea that he had lost that independence which equal discomfort and equal pleasure among them had given him. There seemed a sense of servitude in accepting this luxury which was not his. This set him endeavoring to remember something of his father's house, of the large rooms, drafty staircases, and far-off ceilings,
and the cold formality of a life that seemed made up of strange faces, some stranger his parents, some kinder the servants, particularly the black nurse who had him in charge. Why did Mr. Peyton ask him about it? Why, if it were so important to strangers, had not his mother told him more of it? And why was she not like this good woman with the gentle voice who was so kind to Susie? And what did they mean by making him so miserable? Something rose in his throat, but with an effort he choked it back, and, creeping from the lounge, went softly to the window, opened it to see if it would work, and looked out. The shrouded campfires, the stars that glittered but gave no light, the dim moving bulk of a patrol beyond the circle, all seemed to intensify the darkness, and changed the current of his thoughts. He remembered what Mr. Peyton had said of him when they first met. "Suthin' of a pup, ain't he?" Surely that meant something that was not bad. He crept back to the couch again. Lying there, still awake, he reflected that he wouldn't be a scout when he grew up, but would be something like Mr. Peyton, and have a train like this, and invite the Silsbys and Susie to accompany him. For this purpose, he and Susie, early tomorrow morning, would get permission to come in here and play at that game. This would familiarize him with the details, so that he would be able at any time to take charge of it. He was already an authority on the subject of Indians. He had once been fired at as an Indian. He would always carry a rifle like that hanging from the hooks at the end of the wagon before him, and would eventually slay many Indians and keep an account of them in a big book like that on the desk. Susie would help him, having grown up a lady, and they would both together issue provisions and rations from the door of the wagon to the gathered crowds. He would be known as the White Chief, his Indian name being Suthin of a Pup. He would have a circus van attached to the train, in which he would occasionally perform. He would also have artillery for protection. There would be a terrific engagement, and he would rush into the wagon, heated and blackened with gunpowder, and Susie would put down an account of it in a book, and Mrs. Peyton, for she would be there in some vague capacity, would say, "Really, now, I don't see but what we were very lucky in having such a boy as Clarence with us. I begin to understand him better." And Harry, who, for purposes of vague poetical retaliation, would also drop in at that moment, would mutter and say, "He is certainly the son of Colonel Brandt, dear me," and apologize. And his mother would come in also, in her coldest and most indifferent manner, in a white ball dress, and start and say, "Good gracious, how that boy has grown. I am sorry I did not see more of him when he was young." Yet even in the midst of this came a confusing numbness, and then the side of the wagon seemed to melt away, and he drifted out again alone into the empty desolate plain from which even the sleeping Susie had vanished, and he was left deserted and forgotten. Then all was quiet in the wagon, and only the night wind moving round it. But lo! The lashes of the sleeping White Chief, the dauntless leader, the ruthless destroyer of Indians, were wet with glittering tears. Yet it seemed only a moment afterwards that he awoke with a faint consciousness of some arrested motion. To his utter consternation, the sun, 3 hours high, was shining in the wagon, already hot and stifling in its beams. There was the familiar smell and taste of the dirty road in the air about him. There was a faint creaking of boards and springs, a slight oscillation, and beyond the audible rattle of harness, as if the train had been underway, the wagon moving, and then there had been a sudden halt. They had probably come up with the Silsby train. In a few moments the change would be effected and all of his strange experience would be over. He must get up now. Yet, with the morning laziness of the healthy young animal, he curled up a moment longer in his luxurious couch. How quiet it was! There were far-off voices, but they seemed suppressed and hurried. Through the window he saw one of the teamsters run rapidly past him with a strange, breathless, preoccupied face, halt a moment at one of the following wagons, and then run back again to the front. Then two of the voices came nearer, with the dull beating of hoofs in the dust. "Rout out the boy and ask him," said a half-suppressed, impatient voice, which Clarence at once recognized as the man Harry's. "Hold on till Peyton comes up,"
said the second voice, in a low tone, leave it to him.
Better find out what they were like, at once, grumbled Harry.
Wait, stand back, said Peyton's voice, joining the others, I'll ask him.
Clarence looked wonderingly at the door. It opened on Mr. Peyton, dusty and dismounted, with a strange, abstracted look in his face.
How many wagons are in your train, Clarence?
3, sir.
Any marks on them?
Yes, sir, said Clarence, eagerly, off to California and root, hog, or die.
Mr. Peyton's eye seemed to leap up and hold Clarence's with a sudden, strange significance, and then looked down.
How many were you in all? He continued.
5, and there was Mrs. Silsby.
No other woman?
No.
Get up and dress yourself, he said gravely, and wait here till I come back.
Keep cool and have your wits about you.
He dropped his voice slightly.
Perhaps something's happened that you'll have to show yourself a little man again for, Clarence.
The door closed, and the boy heard the same muffled hoofs and voices die away towards the front.
He began to dress himself mechanically, almost vacantly, yet conscious always of a vague undercurrent of thrilling excitement.
When he had finished, he waited almost breathlessly, feeling the same beating of his heart that he had felt when he was following the vanished train the day before. At last he could stand the suspense no longer, and opened the door. Everything was still in the motionless caravan, except it struck him oddly even then the unconcerned prattling voice of Susie from one of the nearer wagons.
Perhaps a sudden feeling that this was something that concerned her, perhaps an irresistible impulse overcame him, but the next moment he had leaped to the ground, faced about, and was running feverishly to the front.
The first thing that met his eyes was the helpless and desolate bulk of one of the Silsby wagons 100 rods away, bereft of oxen and pole, standing alone and motionless against the dazzling sky. Near it was the broken frame of another wagon, its 4 wheels and axles gone, pitched forward on its knees like an ox under the butcher's sledge. Not far away there were the burnt and blackened ruins of a third, around which the whole party on foot and horseback seemed to be gathered. As the boy ran violently on, the group opened to make way for 2 men carrying some helpless but awful object between them. A terrible instinct made Clarence swerve from it in his headlong course, but he was at the same moment discovered by the others, and a cry arose of go back.
Stop.
Keep him back.
Heeding it no more than the wind that whistled by him, Clarence made directly for the foremost wagon, the one in which he and Susie had played. A powerful hand caught his shoulder, it was Mr. Peyton's.
Mrs. Silsby's wagon, said the boy, with white lips, pointing to it.
Where is she?
She's missing, said Peyton, and one other, the rest are dead.
She must be there, said the boy, struggling, and pointing to the wagon, let me go.
Clarence, said Peyton sternly, accenting his grasp upon the boy's arm, be a man.
Look around you.
Try and tell us who these are.
There seemed to be 1 or 2 heaps of old clothes lying on the ground, and further on, where the men at a command from Peyton had laid down their burden, another.
In those ragged, dusty heaps of clothes, from which all the majesty of life seemed to have been ruthlessly stamped out, only what was ignoble and grotesque appeared to be left.
There was nothing terrible in this.
The boy moved slowly towards them, and, incredible even to himself, the overpowering fear of them that a moment before had overcome him left him as suddenly.
He walked from the one to the other, recognizing them by certain marks and signs, and mentioning name after name.
The groups gazed at him curiously. He was conscious that he scarcely understood himself, still less the same quiet purpose that made him turn towards the furthest wagon.
There's nothing there, said Peyton, we've searched it.
But the boy, without replying, continued his way, and the crowd followed him.
The deserted wagon, more rude, disorderly, and slovenly than it had ever seemed to him before, was now heaped and tumbled with broken bones, cans, scattered provisions, pots, pans, blankets, and clothing in the foul confusion of a dust heap.
but in this heterogeneous mingling the boy's quick eye caught sight of a draggled edge of calico. "That's Mrs. Silsby's dress," he cried, and leapt into the wagon. At first the men stared at each other, but an instant later a dozen hands were helping him, nervously digging and clearing away the rubbish. Then one man uttered a sudden cry, and fell back with frantic but furious eyes uplifted against the pitiless, smiling sky above him. "Great God, look here!" It was the yellowish, waxen face of Mrs. Silsby that had been uncovered. But to the fancy of the boy it had changed. The old familiar lines of worry, care, and querulousness had given way to a look of remote peace and statue-like repose. He had often vexed her in her aggressive life, he was touched with remorse at her cold, passionless apathy now, and pressed timidly forward. Even as he did so, the man, with a quick but warning gesture, hurriedly threw his handkerchief over the matted locks, as if to shut out something awful from his view. Clarence felt himself drawn back, but not before the white lips of a bystander had whispered a single word. "Scalped, too, by God!"